Amen. Well, let's go to Luke chapter 21. And we want to continue today with refusing the care. And the Lord continues to expand this in our thinking and in our spirit, refusing the care. Luke 21, and we'll read one verse here, verse 34. And probably by now you can almost quote it, but that's good. Jesus said, take heed to yourselves. Then he uses this word, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and cares of this life, and so that day come upon you unawares. And so we've been making the point that Jesus said to take heed or be on guard. Watch out. Be careful about this. This is what you need to be looking for. Be careful. And then he used that word, lest. Take heed to yourself, lest at any time. And we talked about this a couple of Sundays ago. The word lest is just one word, but it has a big meaning. Because it means to allow yourself to allow something to become the focus. All right? Lest at any time. So watch out so that there is no time that you allow care to grab your focus. All right? Jesus said you've got to be careful about that. The Woos Bible says it's the anxieties pertaining to the affairs of this life. There's never an appropriate time, according to the Word of God, there's never an appropriate time for a believer to carry care. There's never a time that's appropriate. All right? There's never a time when God goes, well, you know what, I understand that you're worried and overburdened with care, and you know what, really, if I was in your shoes, I might be too. There's never a time that God does that. It's not appropriate. There's no right time to worry. Now I said this before. I said it at Little Rock. I said, now this is one of those series that, you know, it's kind of tough to just sit there and amen your way through it. But sometimes you have to. And here's why. Because, I'll recap this just for a moment. The enemy does his best to make you feel like you're irresponsible if you're not worried. When in fact, being worried is the most irresponsible thing you can do. Why? Because worry holds the door open for everything the enemy wants to bring into your life. Everything that the Lord said to me, he said one of the enemy's main efforts, his main effort is focused on trying to get care into your life. Because if he can get care into your life, he can burden you down. And it holds the door open for everything the enemy wants to bring in. Now remember, this is not just a flippant, oh, I'm not worried about it. The world can do that. That's called denial. You and I have a supernatural force on the inside of us that rises up against care. And we refuse it. It's not that we deny the situation. I'm just not worried about it. Amen. You'll not find the phrase, well, I'd be worried too, in the Bible. That's not in the Bible. And what does it always come back to? What does the Word say? Always comes back to what does the Word say? Worry and anxiety rob you of rest. They rob you of strength. They make you weak. And the thing is, regardless of people will say, well, Pastor, you don't know what I'm going through. You might be worried too if you were going through what I was going through. Hear me. Whether I would worry or not is not the issue. What does the Word say is the issue? It's not whether I would worry. People will say, well, Pastor knew what I was going through. He wouldn't preach on that so hard. Well, yes, I would. Because whether I know you're going through it or not, the Word's still the answer. The Word's still the answer. So, right? There's times I'm standing up here behind the pulpit going through the same thing you're going through, but still having to declare what the Word of God has to say about it. There's no minister that's immune from the things that you go through. You understand? I told Jim one time, I was on a trip, and he was going through some things. I said, man, if I was you, I would just go to the prison tonight and preach on this. Just preach on how God is your source, God is your comfort, God is your way maker, and how the Word's the source. I said, because you're going through something right now, and you need to preach out of your spirit exactly what you're drawing off of. And regardless of what it looks like, God is the way out of this situation. Amen. So, but here's the thing. And not you, because you're faith builders. But other people. I'm talking about other folks. Folks you know. Amen. Right? Tell your neighbor. Say, it's somebody you know. It's not you. Okay, there you go. All right? But here's the thing. People want you to get down there and worry with them. That never helps. It doesn't help them, and it drags you into it. Yeah, but the Bible says weep with them that weep. Well, when somebody's going through a hard time, I might weep with them, but I'm not going to worry with them. Right? I've had people, loved ones pass away in the church, and sure enough, I'd get right down there and hold them and love them and hug on them, let them cry on my shoulder, and I might even cry a little bit. But I'm weeping with them because of what they're going through. But I always had to say, now look, now you got to straighten up here and understand they would not come back here for nothing. They have seen Jesus, and quite honestly, as hard as it is on us. They don't miss this earth. They don't miss Kansas. They don't miss Missouri. They don't even miss coming to church. They are with Jesus. Hallelujah. See, it all comes back to what does the Word say? Go ahead and cry and mourn a little bit, and there's a time for that, but now we got to pick ourselves up. And we got to go on and say, okay, great is the peace of God in my life. And mama or brother or sister or son or daughter or whoever it is, they're with Jesus. I don't know what they're doing exactly, but man, I know it's wow. It's amazing. It's over. They might be creating worlds somewhere. I don't know what they're doing, but I know they're not sick. I know they're not broke. I know they're not crippled. I know they're not in pain anymore. I know they are more joyful than they've ever been before. Hallelujah. So don't worry about how you're going to make it. Don't worry about what are you going to do without them. You're not without them. They just change locations. Right now, my wife is in Arkansas. She's not physically presently here. But I'm not without her. She's just in another location. Your mom, your dad, your son, your daughter, your brother, your uncle, you're not without them. They're just in a different location. Amen. They want you to hurry up and come where they're at. Because they're not coming back here. Amen. Not till it looks like heaven on earth. Amen. Glory to God. Now I went through all that. That's good preaching anyway, wasn't it? But I went through all that to say, yes, there's a time to mourn with people. There's a time to weep with people. There's a time to get down there and pray with them. But the Bible also says there's a time to laugh. There's a time to rejoice. Amen. You've got to know what is appropriate. But here's the thing. It's never appropriate to worry. There are times it's inappropriate to laugh and times it's appropriate to laugh. But it's never appropriate to worry. Because you cannot be in faith by worrying. You can laugh by faith. You can weep by faith. You can weep over something and be in faith about it, but you can't worry about something and be in faith about it. Oh, glory to God. Amen. Now, let's go over here to Matthew 6. And I have to refuse that care. Remember Mark chapter 4, 18 and 19 says it's the entering in of cares. And that word entering in means to visit or to come to or to try to be put into. So that means everybody's going to have care visit you. Everybody's going to have care knock on your door. Now, Ricky, I don't know how it is where you were raised, but if somebody comes to my house and I don't want to let them in, I don't have to. Right? You can come visit all you want, but if I don't want to visit, I don't have to let you in. Amen. I got a peephole. Hallelujah. That's better than having to say, who is it? And you look through the hole, oh, that's Brother Worry. Well, I don't want to visit with him. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, who do you let in? Sister Rejoicing, Brother Peaceful. Amen. Not Brother Worry. Sister Fearfield, we don't want them in. We right? Now my point, far from having you not let people in your house, my point is that's how you've got to do care. No, this is care. I'm not letting you in my house. Because it will come to visit. It will try to be placed in your mind. Now, Matthew 6, we're going to read three verses. We'll start with verse 25. Notice what Jesus said. Therefore, I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat, what you shall drink, or for your body, what you shall put on. Is not the life more than meat, and the body more than raiment? Then verse 31. Therefore, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, what shall we drink, or wherewithal shall we be clothed? Verse 34. Therefore, take no thought for tomorrow. Why? For tomorrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. Now, I went through some translations here just of verse 24 for the sake of time. The Woosh Bible says, stop worrying about your life. And then of verse 34 it says, therefore stop worrying. Therefore do not begin to worry about tomorrow. So notice, stop worrying. Don't begin to worry. The Amplified Bible of verse 25 says, therefore, I tell you, stop being perpetually uneasy, anxious, and worried about your life. And then probably my favorite translation, the Voice translation, said, here's the bottom line. Don't worry about your life. Here's the bottom line. Don't worry. Now, to me, it's completely evident here that Jesus doesn't want us to worry. Because it's prefaced with words like, don't do it. Stop doing it. Don't worry. Amen. Do you see that? Now, let me say this. There are people who try to get away from this. And they'll say things like, well, there have been great men of God in the past that got over into depression and got over into anxiety. And you know, they were plagued with depression and they were plagued with this and they were plagued with that. Well, I understand that. I understand that. But here's the thing. No matter who battled anxiety and depression and worry, you can't get away from the fact that Jesus said, don't do it. Now, see, that's what's hard for a lot of people. Listen, this is not just my opinion. These are the words of Jesus. Amen. Don't do it. Amen. Experience on any level does not and must not be allowed to replace the word. Well, I know Brother so-and-so, and he was a great man of God, and he was just this and that. Okay, but experience does not replace the word, and it cannot be allowed to replace the word. Well, Pastor, why did they go through that and they were a great person of God? I don't have all the answers, but here's what I know. I know at some point they did not have the light on something. It's not my place to say where they missed it, but I'm telling you that I can bring it overall to this. Was Jesus the incarnate Son of God in the earth? Was he capable of healing? Listen, I say capable. Was he capable of healing every disease? Yes, he was, because the Bible says there's times he healed them all. But he could do their no mighty work in his hometown because of their unbelief. And the Greek there, there's a play on that Greek phrase that says he tried to. He tried to heal different people and couldn't because of their unbelief. Now, there are people that will take that and say, see, there Jesus didn't heal everybody. So it's not always God's will to heal. Except for their unbelief, that part about their unbelief. See, I can't allow experience. I've had experiences in my life that just did not make any sense to me. How did this happen? What happened? You got to go back to what the Word says. The Word is not right because your experience is lining up with the Word. The Word is right because it's the Word. You see that? So it is possible to not worry, regardless of who has worried. Well, I knew this great minister and he battled depression a lot. Well, I don't know what to tell you about that, but I can tell you this, I'm not going to. I'm not going to enter into it because someone else did. That's how religion gets over into all these things and talk about it's only your trials, they only come to make you strong. Well, where's that at in the Bible? If I never had a problem, I would not have known that God could solve them. There are things that never showed up in your life because God took care of it and you didn't even know what was going on. I heard a minister say one time, you'll never know you have faith until you're in a good fight. Yes, I will, because the Bible says I have faith. It's not the fight that proves my faith. It's what I believe about what the Word says. Now, faith is for the fight. But you've got to know you have faith before you ever get in the fight. Amen. You better be sure of your shield of faith before you ever show up for the battle. It wasn't the fight that proved my faith. It was the fact that I got in the fight that proved my faith. When you know you've got the victory over something, you don't mind getting in there and scrapping with it. Amen. I'm helping somebody. And when you know you don't have to worry, you're not looking for trials to come and make you strong. No trial has ever made you strong. It's the Word of God, the Holy Spirit, and the power of God that makes you strong. The trial comes and it tries my faith, and it says what that will prove is that the trying of my faith is more precious than gold. In other words, my faith is the most precious substance that I have. It is more precious than money. It is more precious than things. Why? Because when the trial comes, it can take the money and it can take the things, but it can never overcome my faith. Ever. It cannot overcome my faith. Because my faith is the victory that overcomes the world. That's what the book says. That's what the Word says. So it always comes back to what does the Bible say? So there might be times you've got to go to the Lord and say, now Lord, I'm really tempted to worry here, but you said don't. Amen. You said not to worry. So by faith, I'm not worrying. By faith, I'm going to sleep. By faith, I'm not going to think about that. By faith, I'm not going to worry. Pastor, is that work? What does the Bible say? The Word says it works. Hallelujah. That's why the Lord is revealing the light on this subject to us. See, there are ministers and wonderful believers who have died sick, but that wasn't God's will. So that you might know a worried, fretful, depressed, care-filled believer. That's not God's will. Because Jesus said, don't do it. Hallelujah. Am I helping you? Listen. When I was a younger man, much younger, 16, 17, there was a song that came out. And it talked about when you're going through a bad time. Here's what it said. Just turn on them sad songs.
That's what it said.
Turn them on. Turn on them sad songs. When all hope is gone. I'm thinking, I remember being a boy. I mean, probably not the most spiritual stick in the bag, you understand? But I remember being a boy and thinking, that's dumb. Just crawl up into bed and cry when you're sad. Amen. But that's what people will do. They'll draw the shades, turn off all the lights, crawl up in the corner, and just sit there and worry. Isn't that an indication of what's trying to happen? The enemy's trying to consume you? Amen. No, I'm not doing that. I'm a child of the light. Yes. Throw them blinds open. Open the door. Yes. Amen. TTR, it's time to rejoice. Yes. Amen. Why? Because I'm not going to worry about this. Now, folks, I can have empathy with you if you're facing a challenge. Because I've faced challenges and I understand the pressure. But I would be a bad pastor if I didn't tell you, you've got to overcome it. You've got to set your will to overcome that thing. Because at some point, it comes down to what are you going to will to be done? What are you going to will to be done? It's a test of wills. It's the enemy's will, the situation's will against your will. And God can only carry you through as far as you are willing to set your will. Faith will work for everybody. Why does it work better for some people than others? Because there are people that refuse to be moved off what the Word of God says, and they stand by faith regardless of the circumstance. Amen. Amen. Do you see that? So experience does not and cannot be allowed to replace the Word. I say, when it gets quiet, you got to say it. Say, experience is not allowed to replace the Word. Amen. Now, look at, you're there in Matthew 6. Look at verse 32. For after all these things do the Gentiles seek. Your heavenly Father knows you have need of all these things. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. The Amplified Bible says, seek, aim at, strive after, first of all, His kingdom and His righteousness. Then it says, His way of doing and being right. And then all these things taken together will be given to you beside. So notice, these verses contain the reason we don't worry. Your heavenly Father knows you have need of all these things. Seek first the kingdom of God and all and His righteousness and all these things. What are these things? These things people worry and are anxious about will be added to you. When what? When you seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, His way of doing and being right. Well, we've shown from the Word, His way of doing and being right is not to worry. Don't worry. Listen, you never receive what you worry about. If you worry about it, it's not, I mean, you can need something and worry about it. It's not coming. It's just not. Because worry repels the blessings of God. Worry causes none of these things to be added to you. Do you see that? I added something to this verse, what the Lord had asked me, and I added this. What would a man's life look like if he just simply refused to ever worry? I've asked that question a lot of times. What would a man's life look like who simply sought the kingdom of God first? Well, what would a man's life look like if he just simply refused to ever worry? I know he'd sleep a lot better. Amen. There wouldn't be as right? But I've got to refuse the care. People say, well, I'll just do my best and leave the rest to God. I've heard people say that. No, no. Here, listen. You do what God said and expect the results God promised. You don't do your best, and leave the rest to God. You do what God said, and then you expect the results God promised. Nowhere in the Bible will you find that. You just do your best and leave the rest to God. It's not in the Bible. You do what God said and expect the results God promised. So he said, if I won't worry, stop worrying about your life. Seek first the kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things that everybody else is worried about will be added to you on a consistent basis. My job's not worry. His job's to add to. Glory to God. He did not say, do your best not to worry. He didn't say, give it a good try. He said, do not worry. Have you ever talked to somebody like that? And you say, come on now. Come on, you got to get out of that. Don't worry. I'm doing my best not to worry. No, because your best is not. Your best is not worrying. Now, I realize you got to meet people where they're at. There are people here, people in my family, I can just look at them and say, come on, you're worrying and you better quit. And then there's people you got to kind of take them to the Word and say, now look, here's what the Word said. And come on, baby, and dry your tears. Let me pat you on the back and it's going to be okay. Here's a washcloth. Wash your face. And I'm not making fun of those people. There are people you got to meet like that. You got to help them. You might have to listen to them for an hour. Amen. And then help them out of the situation they're in. But eventually I'm going to grow and I'm going to recognize that's worry, that's care, that's anxiety, and I'm not carrying that. Hallelujah. The result of not worrying is all these things are added to me. The result of worrying is the struggle to obtain all these things. I've said this for a long time. I don't struggle. I've told you, you don't struggle. I had a minister get upset with me. Sitting in my house, got upset with me. Because I don't struggle. That's what he said. But you don't struggle. I said, no, I don't. And I'm not going to start for you. That doesn't mean I don't face challenges. But wait a minute. Think about this. What do we believe? If we believe the victory is already won, and I'm here as a winner, not as somebody trying to win, then I'm not in a struggle. I might be in a challenge. You might be challenging me, but I'm not going to struggle. I have won. That's not the question. The question at hand is not, have I won? I've already won because of what the Word of God says. The question is, do you know I've won? The situation, the circumstance is not aware of who they're messing with. They're not messing with somebody that's trying to overcome. They're messing with somebody that realizes that they are seated at the right hand of the Father with Jesus, far above all principalities, all power, all might, all dominion, every name that is named. And that we are presently, currently putting all enemies of the Lord Jesus Christ under our feet. Well, one of those enemies is worry. And you're under my feet. You don't worry about what you have a promise concerning. If you have a promise from God about it, then there's really no, I mean, there's never a reason to worry. But there's really not a reason to worry. Hallelujah. Do you see that? Can you stand some more? Look here at Luke chapter 12. That's all through the Bible. And I'm using mainly Jesus because he was our master. He's our master. And Luke chapter 12, verse 32, notice what it says. Jesus said, and this is the same discourse found in Matthew 6. Jesus said in verse 32, Fear not, little flock. For it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. So fear not. That word fear not, it means to dread or to be fearfully anxious. So Jesus said, don't fear, don't dread, don't be anxious, little flock, because your Father, the Woos Bible says, your Father chose to give you the kingdom. So I don't only have the thing, I have the kingdom at my disposal. Amen. I'm not just getting by, I'm living large. Amen. Do you understand that? Not worrying about it. In other words, if it's God's good pleasure to give us the kingdom, we shouldn't worry about these things. But how am I going to make it? He said, don't worry about that. What are we going to do about this? He said, don't worry about that. See, understand, let me go back and teach you something. Faith begins where the will of God is known. The will of God, according to the word, is don't worry. So until you exercise and you walk into that, faith's not working. Because faith begins where the will of God is known. Amen. And until I start exercising that, faith's not working. Because I've not yet started with what the will of God says. He said, don't worry. He said, don't fear, don't be dreadful or fearfully anxious, because I have chosen to give you the kingdom. What's he trying to say? Listen, what you are believing about those clothes, that food, the things you need on a daily basis, those are small in comparison to the kingdom. And I've given you the whole kingdom. So what he's saying is, so then what do you have to worry about? You have access to the whole kingdom. Amen. You know, when I take my family out to dinner, and we're growing. And you know, when I take my family out to dinner, you know, it's interesting. Nobody worries about how the thing's going to get paid for. Amen. I've never heard my kids walking into the restaurant saying, boy, I'm concerned about this. You know, we better get the littlest thing on the menu. No, they know that El Shaddad is with them. Amen. And it'll be taken care of. Now, I have good kids. They always offer to buy. But the point is that's not going to happen. I'm going to take, but they've never worried about it. You have the kingdom at your disposal. It's been given to you. Amen. Tell your neighbor, the kingdom has been given to me. So I won't worry. When you have the kingdom at your disposal, and you have Jesus who said, stop worrying. And here's why. Amen. It's when all those thoughts start coming. Well, where are you going to get the money? And how are you going to do this? And what are you going to do? If they don't give you that raise, what's going to happen? And they said they were going to this. And they said that. And how are you going to this? And how are you ever going to... You know, you're believing God for this. And how are you ever going to do that? You've never done anything that big in your life. And how can you this? And how can you... Stop worrying. He gave me the kingdom. Amen. Well, what do I do till then? Just keep enjoying your life? Amen. Just keep stepping. Why? Because everything is going your way. You got to quit worrying about it. Hallelujah. Now, look here at John chapter 14. Now, I'm exhorting you heavily not to worry. I'm going to give you the way not to here in a little bit. Oh, it's early yet. I don't even have to hurry. I can slow down a bunch. Hallelujah. John 14 and verse 27. Remember, Jesus is about to leave the earth. And he says to his disciples, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, give I unto you." Now notice these words. "Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid." That word "troubled" means to agitate or to affect with anxiety. Agitate or to affect with anxiety. Do not let your heart be agitated or affected with anxiety. Now, I'm going to tell you something before I move on. He's saying this to men that right now aren't even saved. They're not even filled with the Holy Ghost. And Jesus is telling them, don't let your heart be troubled. But notice the phrase, "let not." That tells me something. That I am in command and control of whether or not I worry and care. Don't let not. The Amplified Bible says, stop allowing yourselves to be agitated and disturbed. Do not permit yourself to be fearful, intimidated, and cowardly, and unsettled. Wow. Stop allowing, do not permit. Now, all of those things are an action that I have to take. So you stop allowing it. I got a text from somebody the other day, and they you know, when you're a person of faith and a man of God, sometimes you have people that text you, and they're questioning God. And this person questions, why did God let this happen? Why did God let that happen? Well, I said, well, number one, I said, you will not bend your will after his, and he's not going to violate your will to make something good happen for you. You're in charge. This person just wants God to come in and start fixing things. Jesus said, you stop allowing. You don't permit it. Amen. Stop allowing, do not permit. So I can stop allowing worry and care. I don't have to permit myself to be fearful. I don't have to allow that. And notice what Jesus said. He said, I'm leaving peace with you. So I'm supposed to focus on the peace I have been left and not the care and the worry and the anxiety that the enemy's trying to bring in my life. Hallelujah. So we don't allow ourselves to be agitated and disturbed. Why? Because we have his peace. Peace is the antidote to worry and care. In Galatians chapter 5, and verse 22. It says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. Now, peace here is one of the fruit of our reborn human spirit. Now, I'm not going to take a lot of time on that. These are not the fruit of the Holy Spirit. They're the fruit of the reborn human spirit. Not the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Fruit of the reborn human spirit. This is the fruit that your reborn human spirit will begin to produce if allowed. Now notice what he says. He says that one of the fruit is peace. That word peace is tranquility. A tranquilness, a tranquility. Now this may be overstating the obvious. But notice that worry is not one of the fruit that we are to bear. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace. Now, peace is like any other fruit of the Spirit. I choose to walk in it. I choose to allow it to manifest in my life. He said, I can, that one of the fruit of the Spirit is love. So I have a choice to walk in love or offense, my choice. I can choose to walk in love and overcome offense. I can choose to walk in love and overcome hatred. Or I can choose to walk in something that's not one of the fruit of my reborn human spirit. This fruit is what I have access to. Amen. He said, I can choose, one of the fruit is faith. Faith. I can choose to walk in faith or choose to walk in doubt. It's up to me. Faith is a choice. Doubt is a choice. Now, Pastor, I don't know how I got over into doubt. You chose to get over into it. You chose to doubt God. Well, no, Pastor. No. It's a choice. Doubt's a choice. Doubt just doesn't come on you and knock you in the head and say, now you're going to doubt and there's nothing you can do about it. And faith doesn't come up and grab you up and say, now you're going to believe God and there's nothing you can do about it. Yes, I can. I can choose to believe or choose not to believe. But I have access to a fruit of the Spirit called faith. It's in my reborn human spirit. It's there. It said another fruit is joy. So I choose joy or I choose sadness. I choose joy or I choose to be non-joyful. It's up to me. Now notice it didn't say happiness. It said joyfulness. Happy is a human emotion. Joy is a fruit of the reborn human spirit. If you ask me if I'm happy about everything I'm facing right now, I would be a liar if I said yes. But am I joyful? Yes, because there's joy in the stand. Romans 15, 13, joy and peace in believing. There's a lot of things I would like to see change that would make me naturally, emotionally happy. But I'm looking for joy, not happiness. Because joy is a fruit of the Spirit. Now, I go through that and say, then he says, one of the fruit of the Spirit is peace. So I choose peace or I choose worry. I choose peace or I choose anxiety. Well, there's just things I can't help but worry about. No. Jesus said, let not and do not permit. So what does the word say? Do not let, do not permit your heart to be troubled, agitated, fearful. Don't allow that. Amen. Yeah, but I just got a bad report. Don't let your heart be troubled. So that means in the midst of that bad report, I am in command and control of whether or not I get worried. Now there again, people will come to you and they'll make you feel like you don't care about, maybe you'll get a bad report about a person, that you don't care about that person because you're not worried with them. When in reality, you know you're not going to get in there and help kill them by worrying about them. I'm going to declare what God said and that's it. Amen. A lot of times what people call praying about something all the time is worrying about it all the time. Now, there are things you pray about and you pray them out and you pray about them consistently. But then there's things that people are praying about and they're not praying, they're worrying. Oh, God, reach down and touch sister so-and-so because, Lord, if you don't touch her, she's going to die. Now, wait a minute. Who's to say he didn't touch her? Do you believe you received when you prayed? Amen. Brother Hagin told the story one time about a man. They were at this man's church actually having a convention, and he suffered a heart attack and was put in the hospital. And his wife sent word to the convention and said, need you all to pray because the doctors are saying this. They're not giving him much chance to live. And there was a man there that they invited to pray, Brother Raymond T. Ritchie. And he was, Raymond T. Ritchie was a very bold man, small man, short man, but very bold. And he was one of the founders of the Assembly of God, and, and just a strong man of faith. Dr. Lester Sumrall wrote about him extensively in his book called Pioneers of Faith, Raymond T. Ritchie. But anyway, he came up and he prayed. And he said, all right, we're going to agree. And he prayed and agreed that God was going to heal Brother so-and-so. And he said, we believe that we receive his healing in Jesus' name. And he walked away from the platform. And he got down and quick, he turned back around and came back up behind the pulpit. He said, so how many of y'all are going to keep praying for Brother so-and-so every day to be healed? And Brother Hagin said, hands went up all over that place. Preachers. You know how Brother Hagin says it? Preachers. And anyway, he said, I didn't raise my hand because I believe I had received when I prayed. Now, don't misunderstand this. Don't just take this because we preach this in faith circles. And you got it in your head. And it's not in your heart. That's mental assent. Why are we not praying about that again? Why have I already given that to the Lord and now I'm not going to worry about it? Because Jesus said, when you pray, believe that you receive. It's not because of a doctrine I'm in. It's not because I'm Word of Faith. It's what the Bible says. If the Baptists will get a hold of they believe they receive when they pray, they'll get the same results we get. The Bible says, Jesus said, whoever will do this will get these results. So did you believe you received when you prayed? Then you never want to go back to God and say, now, Lord, if you don't touch him, I thought he did. I thought you believed you received when you prayed. See, now I'm worrying. Well, they don't look no better and the signs aren't getting any better. Once again, I take you to the Word. The Word calls those things that be not as though they were. It didn't say it calls things that are like they're not. It says that it calls things that be not as though they were. So you're in that hospital room and so-and-so's laying there in that hospital bed and they look like death warmed over. Matter of fact, there's just a blip every now and then and they're barely breathing, but you have believed that you have received their healing. Now you're in there calling things that be not as though they were. I believe there's health in her body. I believe there's strength in his body. I believe there's vitality. Those lungs are functioning. That heart's functioning. That body is functioning and responding to the Word of God because you believe you have received. And you talk what you believe you have received. And you can't worry about something you believe you have received. Am I helping you with this? Amen. Do you see that? Somebody will come and say, I want you to pray with me about so-and-so. I want you to agree with me. What are we agreeing about? I want you to agree with me that they're saved. I want you to agree with me that God's putting ministers in their path, that they're going to turn from darkness to light. I want you to agree with me about that. All right, according to Matthew 18:19, I agree with you about this in the name of Jesus. And 2 weeks later, that person will come up and tell you what a bad shape that person that you just agreed in prayer about is in. Because they have went home and worried about it. And worry robbed them of any faith that was starting in their hearts. Listen, folks, when it's done, it's done. Amen. Your response is, nope, I agreed that I received, according to Matthew 18:19, 2 weeks ago. And I don't care what report I get, I have a choice as to whose report I believe. And I choose to believe the report of the Lord. Am I helping you with this? I choose that. Well, I just wish they'd get to looking better. But see, you're still focused on the wrong thing, whether they ever look better or not. You believe you received. Amen. Well, Pastor, what if they die? If they die, I believe I received. Amen. Listen, I was praying one time. I was up at the hospital. The Lord showed me this with Sister Lillian Bassett. And she had been in the hospital. And I was up there with her. And they had called me up. And she was on in the last stages. And, you know, I always seek the Lord. Lord, what do you want me to do? Because, You know, sometimes preachers just run in and start binding and loosing and casting and kicking and spitting and all, you know. And that's absolutely right when the Lord says it. But I say, Lord, what do I need to do here? Because if what you want is for me to go in there and lay hands on her and get her healed, then we'll do it. I said, but you need to tell me what's going on. Miss Lillian, and she was in her 80s. You know, she had lived a good long life. And I went in and she was in that bed just struggling. And I could tell she was struggling. And her and Randall had supported this church from the time I was pastor here. And I went in, and I remember what the Lord told me. I had prayed with the family, and I was standing there. And you got to recognize, I mean, none of their family was born again, none faith-filled. I mean, they didn't, you know, they were just distraught over the whole thing. And the Lord said, here's what I want you to do. He said, bend down there by her ear and tell her, Lillian, it's okay to go home. And I bent down, whispered in her ear, and I said, Lillian, it's okay to go home. God is my witness. In 2 minutes, she was gone. Now, the reason I use that is I had to go in there and I had to hear what God said. Was it God's will for her to be healthy and well? Yes, and I'd watched God heal her time and time again. I'd watched God heal her husband. God had blessed that couple as far as he could. But it come to a time when I didn't need to worry about what are people going to think, and she didn't get healed, and she didn't. No, God had kept her. She had a long, satisfying life. Now it's time to go home. Amen. Amen. Stay in peace. Hallelujah. I choose whether or not I have peace. So peace is a fruit of the Spirit. So that means it's got to be cultivated. It's got to be tended to. You don't just have peace because it's there. You have peace because you tend to it. You cultivate it. Peace has to be given more time and attention than worry and anxiety. I've got to give peace more time and attention than worry and anxiety. Hallelujah. Now, in Mark 4, so peace is the antidote, but notice this. I'm going to deal with a couple things here. I'm going to try to get through this. If I can't, we'll be back together. Hallelujah. We're not in a hurry. I got the rest of my life. Hallelujah. Mark 4, verse 37. We'll read through verse 39. Now, again, this is one of those familiar scriptures, but notice this. There arose a great storm of wind. The waves beat into the ship so that it was now full. So this is a windstorm of hurricane proportions. The boat is full, the Woos Bible says, to the top. So it's not just a little water in the boat. This is a full boat. And he, Jesus, was in the hinder part of the ship asleep on a pillow. Jesus is asleep. And they awake him and said to him, Master, do you not care that we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, peace, be still. And there was a great calm. Now, Jesus gives us the steps to dealing with care that's trying to overwhelm our minds. First of all, he rebuked the wind. Now, the wind was what was causing the waves to crash into the boat. Jesus had to deal with the source of the issue first. So he rebuked the wind. That means to reprimand or to admonish strongly. You got to reprimand the source of the care. Now I'm going to say something and understand, well, you will understand what I mean. You'll get it. A lot of people want to talk and shout about authority, the authority of the believer, and they don't even have authority over their own mind. You needn't worry about casting out devils if you can't control your own thought life. If the enemy can run in and just make you worried about things, how are you ever going to take authority over a devil in somebody else? You'd be worried he's not coming out. You got to reprimand the spirit. You got to deal with the spirit behind the situation. Now, people shy away from things like this, especially in the day and age we live in, because there's nothing even you got to do with the devil, you know, because Jesus has done it all. So there's nothing we got to do. And that's why you got believers living sinful lives claiming to be believers. That's why you got guys teaching people that even if a person's living in a homosexual lifestyle and they've accepted Jesus as their Savior, they're going to heaven. Because Jesus paid it all and you can't take your salvation away. Isn't that funny though? When Jesus came preaching, he said, repent. Change your mind about things. You understand? Now that's just as true as what I was teaching a minute ago. You got to deal with the source of that. You got to deal with the spirit that's attempting to make you think that way. Folks, listen, I don't take this lightly. I've known people that have battled these things, and I'm not taking it lightly, but I'm helping you. Depression is a spirit of fear. Anxiety is a spirit of fear. Anything that makes you fearful is not of God. Anything that makes you fearful is not natural. You got to deal with the spirit behind the thing. You can go to the doctor and he can medicate you. He can help you to a certain extent, but you still got to deal with the spirit behind the thing. Amen. Am I making sense? And I'm not, you know my thoughts about medication. I'm not going to spend the time getting over into that. If that's where you're at, that's where you're at. You stay in faith and you believe God to get you off of it. But here's the thing. You got to deal with the spirit behind it. And the minute that thing tries to come into your life, you've got to address it from your position of authority. No, that is not my thought. And you spirit that's trying to bring that fear into my life, I reject you in Jesus' name. And I tell you to quit messing with my mind. That's taking your authority as a believer. You understand? You're not going to bind principalities over a city when the enemy can still come into your mind whenever he wants. I want to have control and command over me. Right? So Jesus stood up and reprimanded the source of that thing. He rebuked the wind. So you know the source of that thought is not God, so rebuke it. Your mind is your mind. Your heart is your heart. If you got to sit straight up in your bed in the middle of the night and say, that is not my thought. And you spirit that's trying to produce that thought, get out of my house in Jesus' name. Amen. You got to walk through your house and tell that spirit to get out of your house. Then you just do whatever you've got to do. But you take your authority over it. Well, I'm not talking about being goofy and casting demons out of chairs and lampposts. I'm telling you that there's a very real spiritual battle going on in the earth, and it's centered up on people's minds. And Jesus reprimanded that. Do you see that? You do this by saying something. You cannot deal with a mental attack mentally. Well, I'm just going to change what I'm thinking on. You can't, because it's being supplied to you by an outside source. Am I the only one that you've ever been praying and all of a sudden a thought will come into your mind like, what? I'm in the holy place. I'm clothed with righteousness. How did that stinky thought get in here? And you know, it doesn't have to be a dirty thought or a sinful thought. Just a thought of failure or a thought of whatever, right? a thought about a TV show you watch. What in... That wasn't random. It wasn't coincidental. Listen, you can say what you want about the devil, and I believe he's a punk, and I believe he's a loser, and I believe he's a failure. He is very, very well organized. He sits around and he watches people. And he sees what they like to watch, and he sees what they like to listen to, and he sees what they talk about, and he listens. And then he crafts thoughts that go along with what you have been doing. If you sit around and you say, I'm worried about my kids, get ready for lots of thoughts about kids dying, kids being sick, kids not making it. Why? Because you sit around and you talk about you're afraid your kids aren't going to make it, and the enemy will supply you with thoughts to think on. And the way you think is the way you'll see it, and that's how it'll be. Because you will say eventually what you're thinking. Am I helping you with this? You got to deal with that. If we truly have authority over the enemy and we truly believe it, we got to start with our minds. You're not putting that in my mind. There are people on the sound of my voice. If you're not careful, you keep thinking on what you're going to think on, you're going to get obsessed with it. He's already got you oppressed, and he's working on obsession. I'm saying this by the Holy Spirit, so you take it for what it's worth. He's already got you thinking down a certain line, and you keep thinking down that line, you're going to get obsessed with that way of thinking, and it won't be long, you'll go that way. And I don't care how saved you are and how full of the Spirit you are. You start thinking his thoughts, you're going to go the way he wants you to go. Amen. Well, and the thought is this, what if that comes back? Well, what if it doesn't? See, there's two ways to think. Does Nahum 1:9 say that that affliction will not arise again the second time? Then that's what it says. Well, what if my child, they're doing real good right now, but what if they backslide again? Well, what if they don't? What if Hosea is right that God will hedge up their way with thorns so they can't turn around and go back? You see, I've got a way to... Am I making sense? Amen. And the enemy... Oh, Lord, help me say... Are y'all all right with this? The enemy will pinpoint what he knows gets to you. He'll deal with you about your kids. And all of us, our kids are very dear to us. Right? You don't always like them, but we always love them. But he'll deal with us about that. So you got to keep your mind. Now, who's got to keep your mind? You got to keep your mind from drifting over there into what he's thinking. What he's trying to get you to think. Well, how do you do that? You got to rebuke that. Yeah, but I'm a Christian. That shouldn't be happening. Well, there's nowhere in the Bible that says that. That's the reason you have a helmet of salvation. That's the reason you have the sword of the Spirit. That's the reason you have the shield of faith, breastplate of righteousness, loin belt of truth. There's a reason you have that armor. Amen. Well, then, Pastor, well, how do I end that up? And then you tell him, and I'm not going to think that thought. You can bring it 1,000 times, but I'm not thinking it. What are you doing? You're dealing with the spirit behind the thought. Thoughts, the Lord said to me one time, thoughts are not just thoughts. He said, there are no meaningless thoughts. They all mean something. Amen. You know, how comfortable would you be around somebody that's staying in your house and they say, you know, the other day I had a thought about killing you. Let me rebuke you. You got to go. Yeah. Hey. Right? I'm going to rebuke you. You're leaving. Well, listen. The thief comes not before to steal, kill, and destroy. So those thoughts that he's trying to get in your mind are to steal from you, to kill something, to destroy something. Amen. There are people, the battle in their mind rages so great that when they come to church, they can't hardly enjoy the service because their mind is so cluttered with thoughts of the enemy. You got to rebuke that. Because when you start taking that one thought, the Lord said it to me this way. He said it's like the enemy, it's like you holding the door open for him. Well, that one thought was by one spirit. But here's the thing. The Bible says when one gets a foothold, they bring others with them. Now, there's no fear here. We're not afraid of the devil. But one of the first laws of even natural warfare is know your enemy. If you don't know your enemy, that's why I got a whole series entitled The God of This World, teaching how to recognize the enemy, recognize his actions in your life. When that thought comes and it's not normal, it's not. If there are things that keep going on in your life and you keep saying, this is just not normal, this is not normal, it's not. You've got to deal with it spiritually. Amen. If you are in your home, I'm saying these things by the Holy Spirit, and I don't know, I'm not calling you out, I'm just telling you. If you are in your home and there's no peace in your home, I'm telling you something, and you can think what you want to think about this, there's a demon spirit that's trying to hang out in your home and rob your peace. Great is the peace of the beloved of God. And that's us. Well, what do I do, Pastor? You go through every room in your house and you let that spirit know unequivocally, you're not welcome here and I'm not putting up with you. You're not robbing the peace of my home. You get out of here in Jesus' name. Because that's my home. Am I helping you?
Yes.
Well, what's that got to do with worry? That's where all those thoughts are coming from. The enemy's got an inside man. And he's producing thoughts of worry and thoughts of care and thoughts of concern. Oh, glory. I'm not going to get through all this, but I need to give you these points if you'll give me a minute. So you got to reprimand this. How do you do it? You do it by saying something. Then he spoke. Peace be still. Now, when you look at peace be still in the Greek, Jesus said, be still and settle down. But then there's even a deeper meaning. That phrase, be still, it means be silent. Keep silent. Now, isn't it interesting when Jesus dealt with demon spirits? And they would start saying something, he'd say, hold your peace and come out of him. Didn't he? You don't let the devil talk. I said, you don't let the devil talk. You tell him to shut up and stop that. In the name of Jesus. He's not afraid of you, but he's afraid of Jesus. He's afraid of the name. At the name of Jesus, every knee bows. Every tongue confesses that Jesus is Lord. Now, I know this can sound over-spiritualized, but listen, this is the reality of it. If you let the devil keep talking, he's going to get you over into care. And you can't afford to get there. It takes you longer to dig yourself out of a hole than it did to dig the hole. You understand? Then, be still, settle down. Settle down means to muzzle, to put to silence. So when he said, peace be still, he muzzled the wind. He put it to silence. Glory to God. You got to speak to the situation trying to produce care and tell it to be silent and keep silent. Put a muzzle on the situation by speaking peace. I'm not going to have that here. You're not going to cause worry in my home. This is my sanctuary. This is my peace place. And I'm going to be peaceful here. I'm going to sleep peacefully. I'm going to eat peacefully. I'm going to enjoy my life peacefully. Why? I'm the establishing witness. It's my mind. It's my heart. It's my home. Those are my kids. That's my marriage. That's my finances. And you're not messing with them. Amen. Jesus spoke peace. Notice this. Now, these last two points I really want to get to you. From the peace that had been cultivated in his spirit. You can't speak out of your spirit what's not in your spirit. You can't speak out of your spirit what's not cultivated in your spirit. So you got to spend time cultivating the fruit of peace in your spirit. I'm going to be peaceful. Well, how will I do that? You're going to have to spend time getting in the Word about what the Word says about peace. You're going to have to listen to what the Word says about peace. Get you some peace scriptures. I'm going to have peace in my life. And peace is a weapon. It's not only a fruit, it's a weapon. How do I know that? Because one of the pieces of the armor that we have is our feet are shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. That's not just witnessing to people. The gospel of peace. We have killer shoes. Amen. The Bible says in the book of Romans that the God of peace will trample Satan shortly under your feet. That doesn't mean in a little while. That word trample shortly under your feet, it means with short, violent, stomping steps. So God's, amen, pound the devil under your feet. I have killer shoes on and I'm going to walk all over you. And they're shoes of peace. It's a weapon. It's not just a fruit. It's a weapon. And the enemy doesn't know what to do with somebody that will not be worried. Because there's no weapon he can form against you if you won't worry. What can he do if you won't worry about anything? Hallelujah. When care attempts to get into your mind, speak peace and refuse the care. I'm speaking to you. I'm telling you. You're not getting in my mind. My mind is my mind. I was sitting one day, I'm closing with this, and I was looking at the things that the Lord had asked us to do and was asking us to do, still asking us to do. And, I've never been the kind of person ever since the Lord's asked us to do things to focus on what's it going to cost. I mean, that's not the point. Now, but I was sitting there, I was watching, my whole wall was full of what God has asked us to do. I was looking at that, and I just kind of sat back in my chair, and I just said, Lord, how are we going to do this? And he said something. Now, I'm making a point with this. He said, son, you have to do this. You have to do it. And I could tell in his voice, it's, I don't have anybody else to do it. You've got to do it. When Dr. Les Summerall heard Clarita Villanueva being bitten by demons at Billy Bit Prison in the Philippines, and he heard it on the radio, they were there, they said, this monster's destroying this young woman. The Lord said, I want you to go to that prison and deliver her. Dr. Summerall said, get somebody else. I don't have a deliverance ministry. And the Lord said, I don't have anybody else. Could it be the reason the enemy tries to plague your mind and keep you beat down and keep you in a place of worry and anxiety is he's trying to keep you away from what God wants you to do? There are people on the sound of my voice. God's got things for you to do that he's asked other people to do, and they won't do them. The Lord told me, he said, you were not my first choice for this ministry. You were third. You were my third choice for this ministry. And he showed me where these other men got off, and he told me he'd given both of them 5 years to do it, and I was in the fifth year of my ministry here. And he said, now I've given you 5 years. Now will you do it, or do I need to get somebody else? I said, Lord, I'll do it. And we've done it. We've done to the best of our ability and our faithfulness to do what God's asked us to do. But here's the point that I'm trying to make. And we've done it with thoughts at times of trying to invade our mind that you're not going to make it. You're going to fail. Coming out here and preaching on a Wednesday night, God talking to you about an international ministry, and you got eight folk. And about three of them were there voluntarily. The other ones had to be here because they had a job. Some were family. They had to show up. And you're preaching about vision and casting vision to eight people. And some of them are going, amen. I look back on this, and the reason why I can finally preach messages like this is I've proven this. I'm not a wild-eyed novice anymore. I'm not just up here saying something that sounds good from the Word of God. I've proven this. If at any time we would have allowed care and anxiety and worry about failing to get into our minds, we probably wouldn't be sitting in this room today. Because you just can't allow it. Don't worry. And I'm telling you, the unction of the Holy Spirit, listen to me, don't worry. It's all going to turn around. Everything God said is going to come to pass. It's just a matter of meeting God at the place of faith and seeing it occur in your life. Amen. You know, this phrase has been going over and over in my spirit, and I know I'm taking a minute, but the Holy Spirit is in charge. There's an old song, and we don't sing it much in church anymore, when I was a boy growing up. And they usually sang it around the invitation. And it said, just as I am, without one plea, just as thy blood was shed for me. Amen. And that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come. Yeah, it's been rolling over and over in my spirit all weekend. And over the weekend, I saw myself standing behind this pulpit. And I don't know who it applies to. It doesn't matter who it applies to. He's saying to you, you come to me just as you are. Just like you are. With all the failures and the mistakes and the things that you think are going to keep you from doing what God said you were called to do and God said you could do. You've got to come to Him just like you are. And let Him remove the baggage so you can keep going. But it begins with me saying, just as I am. I'm not going to try to fix things. I'm not going to try to make this right. I'm just going to show up and I'm going to do what you told me to do. I'm not necessarily going to call anybody to the front. I'm telling you, if that's you, you got to grab a hold of that and you got to go. But then right on the other hand, there are people in the sound of my voice, and you hear me and hear me well. And I don't know who it is, but I'm going to say it as boldly as the Holy Spirit is saying to me. You're not doing what God told you to do. And you're holding back. And He told me to tell you very implicitly, don't think He's going to keep asking you. Because the more you hold off, somebody right now is preparing to do what God's called you to do. Whatever that capacity is, that's not a threat. That's the love of God. God will get the job done. And He wants to get it done through me, and He wants to get it done through you. But He'll get it done through whomever is willing. Do you see that? I said, do you see that? So you say, Pastor, that's me. Well, then just repent. Repentance is always the way out. Repent and tell the Lord, I'll do what you're asking me to do. I'll do it. I'll make it happen. And then you're square. Do you see that? Let's pray today. Let's bow our heads. Let's pray today. Hallelujah. Father, first of all, we thank You for the Word. We thank You for the power of the Word of God to change our lives. And Father, we just come together as a body today. And Lord, if there are those under the sound of my voice that feel like that there's been things in their life that have kept them back, I'm asking that they would just make that decision today to say, Lord, just as I am, I'm coming to You. And I'm bringing this to You, and I'm expecting You to take this burden and give me the liberty that You desire for me to have. Hallelujah. And Father, if there are others that would say, Lord, that's me. I'm not pressing into what you've asked of me. But I want to repent today. And I want to move forward with what you're asking of me. Father, let that begin in their heart. Let that begin in their spirit. Take that step to do all you've asked of them. Lord, I'm grateful for that in the name of Jesus. Now, Father, I just pray for every person under the sound of my voice. I pray that the eyes of their understanding would be enlightened. I pray that they would be endued with the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of who you are. One translation says, the richest measure of the fullness of God. Lord, I thank you that they are endued with that from on high. I thank you that they have capabilities that they've yet to tap into. I thank you that they have abilities and mindsets that they've yet to see. But I declare by the power of the Holy Spirit that the destiny that's within them and the greatness that's within them will begin to cry out and come out, and they will see great things from the Word of God, great things from the kingdom of God, and great things from the hand of God. I thank you that the hand of our God is upon us. And I thank you, Father, that you send your word. It is on us for good and not for evil. And Lord, I thank you that you're leading, guiding, and directing each of our steps. And that, oh, thank you, Lord. And even propelling and accelerating us. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord, oh, Lord. Barbara, that's what the Lord just told me. There's a propellant coming into your spirit and an accelerant. And understand this. With Michael going home to heaven, here's something that's happened. There's coming an acceleration now. I don't know what God's been dealing with you about, but there's coming an acceleration of things coming to you and you moving to things. And it's in your spirit. It's an accelerant and a propellant, and you're going to get to it faster than you thought you would. Faster, faster, faster. I believe God. So, Lord, we walk into that in the name of Jesus. Glory be to God. Amen? Amen. Praise God. Well, let's stand on our feet today. As you're standing up, say, I'm not going to worry. I'm not going to care. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, God is good to us. Amen. I believe God. Amen. Praise God. Well, God's going to do some good things. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, tonight we'll be back at 6. We'll have Bible doctrine at 4:30. Some good things planned there. 6 o'clock tonight, we'll be back ministering the word. I'm hoping that we get to start teaching on favor. That's what the Lord has been dealing with me about. I don't know for sure. We'll see. But it's going to be good regardless. Amen. So praise God. Come on, say it with me. The vision of our church will always be to build people's faith and frame their world by the word of God. And you and I will always be world changers. Hallelujah. Praise God.